Well, thank you so much for coming.
Okay, everyone, we're cranking up. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to those of you who've made it till the end. This is the last panel standing in between you and a drink at the reception or a bike ride or whatever you're doing after this. I want to first thank my fabulous conference co-chairs, Frank Lamonti, Richard Griffiths, and Jonathan Peters for all the hard work that went into making today a success. And of course, thank you to all of the moderators throughout the day and the speakers. We could not do this without you. So this final hour, we are going to devote to the topic of artificial intelligence, or AI. And in the last year, it's become really impossible, even for non-techies like myself, to ignore how omnipresent AI is in our society now. We'd all gotten pretty familiar with the kind of garden variety AI that does things like personalize what Netflix recommends that we watch, or that tells us the best way to go home based on traffic conditions. But recently, and by that I mean within the last 15 months or so, there's just been an explosion of a much more sophisticated type of generative AI that works not just with text, but obviously with images and sound as well. And so while the technology behind generative AI has been around for a while, since as early as the 1960s, the acceleration that we're currently experiencing started most noticeably with the launch of ChatGPT in November of 2022, and of course now ChatGPT is a household name. And a couple months after that, we saw Microsoft introduce their Bing Chat, and now that's been renamed as Copilot. Google has introduced a sort of conversational AI service called Bard. The company Meta introduced AI into Facebook Messenger. And the legal research engine Lexis now has Lexis AI that, according to its promotional materials, summarizes, researches, and responds like a trusted colleague. And that sounds just lovely. So these are just a few examples of the many different ways that AI is being put to use in a very new and powerful way across all different sectors. And it's changing how we practice law, it's changing how we train law students, and it's also changing, of course, and having a huge impact on the fields of media and journalism. And so here today to talk with us about the good, the bad, and the as yet unknown about AI, we have three esteemed and wonderful panelists. I'm going to give brief introductions of them, but there's more information about their impressive pedigrees and many, many accomplishments in our speaker's bio packet. But first we have Professor Christian Turner, who is Associate Professor of Law at the University of Georgia. His research interests include legal philosophy, law and mental modeling, and institutional theories of law. And then we have next to him, Ted Claypool, who is a partner at Womble Bond Dickinson LLP, where he leads the firm's IP transaction team. He's also vice chair of the ABA President's Task Force on Law and Artificial Intelligence. And then we have the honor of having Janita Du with us today. She is Executive Vice President of Integrity and Inclusion for CNN Worldwide, as well as the Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer for CNN and TNT Sports. So she wears both of those huge hats simultaneously. And so to make the most of our time, we're going to just dive right in with our first question, which I'll address to Christian and Ted. And so here it is. Most of us can use the phrase AI or artificial intelligence in a sentence, but fewer of us actually understand what it is, apart from some sort of computer program. So in a nutshell, can you tell us a little bit about how AI works and how the generative AI that we are experiencing now is so different from what we were seeing only a few years ago?
Hi, everybody. Good to see you. It is remarkable, the explosion of application for AI. We're now at a level of machine generation that I did not expect to see in my lifetime. And I'm kind of a computer kid. You know, I grew up playing computers, and I have a math background, so I didn't expect to be completely floored by what was possible. And the upshot is there's one kind of artificial intelligence involves having a sequence of things and then predicting the next element of that sequence. And that can be, you know, pixels in an image, bits of sound, or text. And you can do that at the level of characters or of words. And so we could try to create fancy models of these things, like if then, and try to encode logic, or you can do what I used to do as a mathematician, which is come up with differential equations to predict how systems evolve. But another way of solving this problem is to curve fit, right? Just to figure out, well, here's some parameters that seem to work. We don't know why. Maybe these parameters work okay, and we nudge them a little bit. They work a little bit better. If they work better, let's keep nudging them until they work even better. And so the techniques for doing this, though, involved taking inspiration from the human brain, and you've probably seen these images in the newspapers of these lattices of or networks of nodes that things are passed through and small calculations are made. So for a long time people worked on these. It turns out that if you wanted to know what the next word is in the sentence that I'm saying right now, it's important not just the word that comes right before that word, but all the other words that came before that and the relations among those words. And so the way that people would do this is they would pass all the words through one of these networks, and then based on some calculations, you would go back up and you would nudge things a little bit. So you'd have to pass all these words through kind of one at a time, adjust parameters, and these are recurrent neural networks, if you've heard the word. So you kind of have to keep looping back up, and this was difficult to parallelize. And so it's rare in science and tech that you'll have one paper or one discovery that kind of changes everything. But in the mid-20-teens, there's this paper that you probably have heard of called Attention is All You Need, where a group of researchers then at Google, now kind of spread across the industry, describe and announce the invention of a technique called a transformer. And since then, this particular way of doing this, predicting the next word in a sequence or next element of a sequence, has taken over everything, not just language, but also images, and it's been incorporated into models for sound, for all sorts of things. If you're particularly savvy, you might think maybe it could predict the next price and the evolution of the stock market. So that happened. And you can see this on a graph. So when it's when these calculations are slow, because every calculation depends on all the ones above it, and you have to keep, you know, running the same token through, model sizes were kind of small. You can only have a certain number of parameters, maybe a few million, maybe a few hundred thousand. And after the invention of the transformer, it just goes up exponentially. So that by GPT-3, the original ChatGPT, you have more parameters, more visible nodes, than you have neurons in the human brain. So the human brain has about 80 billion neurons, so you get quickly, like orders of magnitude improvements, such that GPT-4, they thought was like a trillion neurons, it's probably more like 250 billion, but there are three of them talking together and coordinating. So that paper changed a lot, and then over the years with training, we now have these models that have seemingly exploded onto the scene. And it turns out that going from a few million quote-unquote neurons to more than the number of neurons in the human brain makes all the difference in the world. So now these things behave seemingly lifelike in response to generating prompts to generate images or to generate stories or briefs or judicial opinions. That's, I don't know, in a nutshell, that's basically in a nutshell the history of this stuff. And that, you know, you've probably heard that these are just kind of fancy autocorrect, or they're fancy like next word prediction things. That's probably kind of true. I'm someone who thinks that the human mind is also kind of a fancy next word, next token prediction machine, and we attend to these predictions that we have. So the scale here is so unimaginable that to describe them as just predicting the next token doesn't get at all of the model of the world and language that they have built in that enables them to do that. Okay, so I'll stop there. There's a lot we're going to talk about, but yeah.
Yeah, and let's, hitting this as a practicing lawyer, you really have to think about it a little differently, in that we tend to think of things functionally, right? What does it do? What does it do, and what problems is that going to cause for me and my clients? There are a few different types of things that we're calling AI. You know, the science fiction writer Ted Chiang, when somebody asked him what AI was, he said a bad choice of words in 1954. That essentially this is not a thinking machine, although you're probably right. The gestalt that we have in our own brains may be masking the fact that we do some very similar things. But if you think about it this way, generative AI is one interesting category, and it has a number of legal issues just in that category, and we'll talk a lot, particularly in this media discussion, about intellectual property and why it's used there, what the cases are in that space. But the other kinds, a lot of other kinds of AI, and you look at their functions, they have their own set of legal issues. One of them that already is regulated, in Europe at least, is what I call decisioning AI. AI that decides whether or not you get a loan, whether or not you get parole. There are these elements out there that have been used for a long time, and those have a lot of legal issues involved, especially bias, which we'll talk about a lot later today. But there are other types. There's AI that identifies you from a biometric standpoint. There are constitutional issues with that, as to whether or not you can be picked out of a crowd, a peaceful crowd, by the government, and singled out and have them identify your name with the AI. There's a lot involved in that. And then there's, of course, AI that runs the automated vehicles, and other AI running out here in the wet world. And that has its own set of legal issues, insurance and otherwise. So I'll stop there, but I just want you to think about it a little bit more in the way of considering what's its function, what does that do, what does that mean for your clients?
So you've already mentioned some of the benefits of AI, which is that it works more quickly and mostly more accurately than humans ever could. And it can very quickly synthesize large amounts of data into a coherent narrative. It can automate tasks that otherwise humans have to spend time doing them manually. It can make people feel less lonely, And it can help people be better communicators. And those are just some of the good things about AI. And then you also mentioned a few of the, you know, downsides or concerns about it, that it hallucinates, it makes up facts or inaccurate information. It can perpetuate bias in ways that are harmful to marginalized groups. It can make it really hard to tell what is real and accurate and what is fake. It feeds off human-generated content without always crediting or compensating the people who took the time and money to make that content. And it also has the potential to disrupt existing business models in a lot of professions, but we're most concerned today about the legal profession and in the media. And so with that kind of like big overview of like, there's a lot of good things about it and there's also a lot of concerning things about it. I'd like to start with Janita and just ask you, you know, what's your top 10 list of both like the best things, the biggest benefits for a field of journalism and also some of the most scary things?
I really, seriously, you just laid the groundwork so well. And by the way, listen, Kristen, great job in sort of setting the stage and describing AI. That's wonderful. And now it's clear why you were chosen to do that. So thank you for that. I am a novice in the sense that I'm not a technological person. Yet, obviously, all of us sitting in this room need to understand AI because it is transforming our society and certainly our industries and our profession. And I'll speak, obviously, relating to journalism and the news media. I mean, I think I'd like to characterize the benefits relating to journalism in three areas. And these are the areas where we really focus our efforts and our exploration around AI. We look at protection, we look at productivity, and we also look at revenue. And in terms of protection, obviously, as news media, we want to ensure that we are not going to be reporting on or propagating deep fakes or altered video and images and audio and things like that. You think of the Biden robocall, right? These are things that are really important to our brand, to our integrity, to ensure that anything that we report is accurate and that it is authentic. And so exploring how we can use AI to better protect ourselves and detect that kind of misinformation and to ensure we're not spreading misinformation and disinformation a la fake news is very important, and AI is crucial in that regard. Also, we're very focused on productivity. We've all said it. I mean, it's clear that AI, you know, you think about when the light bulb was invented, I mean, things changed drastically, and so we all have to be prepared as to how things will change relating to journalism and productivity, ranging from news gathering and utilizing AI to help us with large data sets and identifying stories and things like that, to story production, to helping our journalists compile information, not just information relating to other stories, but internally. I mean, Richard Griffiths knows very well, there's a vast amount of information at CNN through guidance notes and other types of wires, past stories and everything else, figuring out the best ways to compile that information so it's available for our journalists. And then also revenue. I mean, let's be real. We'll talk about it a bit more later, but clearly as content creators and as the people who have invested all of the time, the energy, and the editorial discretion around storytelling, I think any news organization, any media company recognizes that there's a value to what we've created. And so it's very important that we are remunerated appropriately, and there's also opportunity to make our content available potentially in some of those other areas we've discussed.
Great, and I guess the second part of the question was like, what's most concerning to you, or what keeps you up at night thinking about how AI is so present in the field of news media?
The biggest concerns really, especially for somebody like me in my role, where the standards and practices team reports into me, is just making sure that we are upholding our brand integrity. So the biggest concern is that we're going to report on something that's not real. And that is very scary. And so we want to do all that we can to prevent that from happening. Aligned with that, I'd say another area of concern is this concept of hallucination, right? Where you have these generative AI services that spit out information based on content that they've been trained on coming from companies like ours, but sometimes the information isn't accurate. You know, AI is not perfect, and sometimes we're misattributed, or sometimes our name is associated with content that we didn't create and that we certainly did not vet. And so that's also concerning because that does damage the brand, right? We know that the media has been under attack, and so for a thriving democracy, we need to ensure that that the media is valued and viewed as that fourth estate of government, which we strive to be. And then, you know, my other role relating to diversity, the concept of bias, well, what are all these services and tools being trained on? Like, how do you determine what is the most important and relevant information out there, and is there some sort of bias? And so those are some of the major things I worry about. And then, of course, we'll talk about later, copyright infringement is a major area of concern.
Sure, thank you. So Ted, just to talk a little bit more about your practice before I hand it over for you to give me your sort of list of pros and cons. So you draft and negotiate IP agreements and other contracts for clients that involve very sophisticated technology and data services, as I understand it. And you also counsel clients on privacy and cybersecurity relating to online interactions, and usually financial services or often financial services. And so that's a really different field than what Janita is interacting with in terms of AI. And so I'm just really curious how AI is a helpful tool in your field, maybe an amazing, awesome tool in some respects, and then also what you know, you really have to look out for when you're counseling your clients with respect to AI.
Yeah, there are a number of things to think about. And once again, I want to make another distinction in types of AI, because in answer to your question, what's the most useful is what I would call extractive AI. Right? And the extractive AI is something you can ask a question and it's only going to answer based on what you fed into it, right? So it's not out there downloading all of CNN's content. It only uses your content. And that's enormously helpful to us at the moment, because if you have 23 hours of depositions, you know, it's nice to feed them all into something and say, summarize this for me and tell me what the most important issues are. Or we're looking at this particular topic, how many times did it come up in that pile of depositions? You know, and that saves you a lot of the problems that you're talking about, because it's actually using only the stuff that we're giving it. Now, you know, obviously there have been some famous legal hiccups dealing with hallucination, and that's because that, you know, generative AI, even though they're trying to push it as this, it's not a search engine, right? That's not what it does. It is, you know, as Dr. Turner will talk about a little bit more, it's a prediction engine. It predicts what should be coming next in a lot of ways, and so it's not making stuff up. It is just predicting something that doesn't exist. And one of the real problems with it from a legal standpoint, and one of the big problems for the people in the Avianca case, where they turned in a brief to the court that had hallucinated sites in it, well, the problem is that AI also then doubles down on its own problems, because these guys went back when somebody pushed them on it, right? I mean, lawyers get hit with this first. Why do we get hit with it first? Because if you're using it wrong, then you turn it into a court, then automatically somebody is going to attack it, because that's their job. And then the court gets to talk about it, and then it becomes public. So that's part of why we are some of the first people that get to see this. But the guys that turned in the hallucinating case document that they turned to the court was then asked the AI, said, find me these sites that you gave me. Were they real? Well, it said, of course they're red. And it said, well, find them for me and print them out for me because the judge is asking. So it made those up, right? Because it's just predicting what that should look like. So anyway, from a legal standpoint, one of the things that you have to remember in all of this is, from a lawyer's perspective, everything you put your name on, you have to be sure about, period, the end. That's not hard, that's rule 101 of the model rules of professional responsibility. It shows competence and understanding of the technology that you're using, but everything that you put out, you have to be sure what's in there. So it's not that you can't use the AI, which could potentially hallucinate. It's more that whatever you get, whether you get it from your assistant, from a junior attorney in your firm, from anybody else, you still better read it and make sure that what's in there is correct. And that's sort of where we're coming from. But one other thing I want to at least mention is deepfakes, which from an evidentiary standpoint are going to be a nightmare. I mean, that's already a really huge issue, and that you can't tell the difference between something that is completely faked, if it's well done by an AI, and something that is a real video, audio, or photograph.
So just to follow up on that, just in researching for this panel, it was my understanding that there is the technology to determine, is this a deep fake or is this real? And at least for now, that is keeping pace. But are you saying that it's actually going to soon be hard to really even tell with the right software if it's
yes.
a deepfake?
Yes. I mean, there are some strategies that people are suggesting, but we have no idea whether they'll be effective.
And I do think a lot of companies are pitching their technology, and I think many of us are testing their technology, but they're not, as Ted just said, they're not necessarily effective, or obviously they need to evolve. There's work that needs to be done in that regard.
Well, I think of it like data security. You talked about that in my practice earlier. I mean, data security, if I ever really wanted, I'm talking to a reporter and I want them to actually quote me in their article on data security, I will say something like the cobra and the mongoose, this is an eternal problem, a fight between the good guys and the bad guys, or something along that line. And that's gonna be the case with deepfakes as well, is it's going to be an arms race between the people who are trying to make sure you can't tell the difference, and those giving the liars dividend from the fact that you can't tell the difference. And those people who are trying to make sure that the law can be enforced correctly and you can tell a difference.
So Christian, turning to you, from the perspective of a law professor and a legal educator, how is AI impacting how we train students to do some of the core legal tasks like legal research and writing? And also, what do you think new lawyers are going to need to know about how to use AI to be competitive and confident in a world where everyone is using it, and that's the expectation?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think anyone knows. I mean, for me, it's hard to see the profundity of change when you're in the middle of it or at the beginning of it. You know, NVIDIA just released it. They make graphics cards that maybe your kids like use for video games, but turn out to be central to parallelizing this process of training AI and inference. They're now a $2 trillion company approaching Apple's market capitalization, and they make graphics cards, right, that are powering this. There is an unparalleled, I think, investment in this effort. Unparalleled in, I don't know, human history, but like a massive amount of investment is going into this. For me, this is, you know, looking at it, where would I put this? I would put this as like the change, like you said, electrification, like the invention of electricity, not the invention of the computer, not the invention of social networks or the internet, like electricity, like that profound. And so, you know, how do we train lawyers who, you know, in an era where we didn't have electricity, but now we are, like, it's really hard to think about. I am, like, careful though of, I think we have this this bias when it comes to, because computers have always been really good at the things that we're really bad at, and vice versa, like the things that we're really good at, they're bad at, like being able to see things and carry on the conversation. And this like changes all of that. And so now I'm very suspicious, anytime someone says like, yeah, a computer can do this, but you always need a human to do X. I don't think that statement is safe for any value of X. What's special about us, I think, is going, it just can't be the things that we uniquely can do, right? It has to be us. We value us for our own sake, right? So for me, legal education is going to increasingly be about investing in the humanities, investing in us. We are going to continue telling our story and take ownership of that, not because we're the dominant thinker on earth or the most powerful this or the best thinker about this, but because we care about us and we care more about us than anything else does. So for me, I think about the humanities and the place of law within the humanities and locating it there more and more and making it less and less a kind of specialized field where we do things that are kind of uniquely legal, and more about thinking about like what are core human values. And how can we talk to each other about our disputes in a way that expresses those core human values? So it's kind of deep. It kind of comes back to like what law is all about. But I think this is that kind of moment. I can address more particular things. I think your question was like more particular than that. But I also don't want to monopolize the conversation. But I think it's very profound. So
Yeah, I mean, I hear you saying that we need to sort of preserve our humanness and elevate the facets of legal thinking and legal theory that are uniquely human and less automated, because the computers are going to be able to do the automation. But I do think writing is still in that gray area where like AI can do something, but it's not very good yet.
Well, so at a practical level, what I'm doing with my students now, right? I think the model is going to shift toward new lawyers being less like the engines of writing that are managed by partners. Everybody is going to be their own partner with their own stable of good associates, right? So every new lawyer is going to be a manager of thinking machines. And go out and find this for me, write up this for me. Now my job is to edit that, think about how it works in the way that I want to talk to other people involved in this dispute or other people that I'm working with. So, and I've done that by showing them, here's some answers that GPT-4 will generate for a typical exam, and it does pretty well. If you prompt it in the right way, for some questions it does better than others. But the other thing to realize is that we're just at this really incipient stage where what we have now in GPT-4, for example, or in Gemini from Google, they're just language models. They're just models of language. Your own conceptual life, your own kind of mental life consists of lots and lots of models, right? So we're all good language modelers. Some of it is better than others. I trip over my words sometimes, right? But we're all good language modelers. But we also have models of our social relations, right? We're always kind of having a sense of how we sit within the pack. That's very much a part of being human. We have visual models. We're predicting constantly what we're seeing. We're taking input. We're correcting those models. And so we have a rich visual life and an auditory life. We have a sensory life. You have a whole set of models about your internal state, right? Interoception, where things don't feel quite right, and you can kind of know that. And so all of this is somehow integrated in a way that helps to keep us alive. It's come down to us through natural selection. All we have now in these machines is a language model. But as you know, with GPT-4, they started to integrate vision, and pretty soon it'll be sound, and then maybe there'll be other models of sociality, models of like logic and reasoning. So when you put these together, you get something way more powerful than any one model alone. If you want to think about it, like think about when someone asks you a math question, like the mode that your brain, a lot of us get like defensive about this, like how do I calculate this? But like your brain is kind of doing a different thing. You're thinking in a slightly different way, and it's communicating with your language in a way that you can give an answer. So what you see now, I think, is a preview of what's to come. But I wouldn't rely on the fact that my students will always be the truth makers. Like this will babble some text and they'll have to check and see if it's right. I think it's not too far until we're pretty sure that the machine is more likely than not going to be more right than a human being going out researching things. But we'll see.
Yeah,
Yeah, but I mean, let me be devil's advocate for that for a minute. I mean, right now we have.
I thought I was representing the devil there.
Well, I mean, I think there are a lot of people that have that position, and I don't, you know, and ultimately, you're probably right, but it's a question of degrees and timing, and one of the issues that we have now is that there really is no general AI. What we have are models to do one thing, play chess, give language, do paintings. I mean, I'm a great artist now that I have AI, you know, but I can have it do things that I can never draw with my hands. But from a lawyer's standpoint, well, my dad was a lawyer, and he used to say no lawyer is worth shit for 5 years or so. And why is that? Because it's a judgment job. And the reason people call us is for our judgment. And it takes lots and lots of experience and looking at things in many, many different ways. Ethical models are something you're also gonna have to build in. You know, to get judgment. And that's really, I think, what we're where we are. If we can use the AI, but we can still be the people that bring the judgment to it, you know, I think we have the, we'll meet the, I forget who said it, the statement that AI isn't gonna replace lawyers, but lawyers who know how to use AI will replace lawyers who don't know how to use AI.
And I just wanna add to some of that discussion about being human, right? And to borrow from the New York Times in their lawsuit, which we'll talk about later, journalism is deeply human in the sense that it takes courage, it takes tenacity, it takes fact-checking, it takes context, it takes experience. And so facts may be able to be replicated, not always 100% properly, but all those other things cannot be. And similar to what you're saying about your students and lawyers in general, all of those elements are needed to be strong journalists. And so it is important to ensure that the human factor continues to be dominant in, you know, when we're working with AI.
Yeah, thank you for that. So we are gonna talk about copyright now. So I think most folks have heard, or maybe not, that the New York Times has filed a sort of groundbreaking lawsuit against OpenAI, which is the company that owns ChatGPT, and also against Microsoft. And both of these AI companies have used millions of the New York Times articles that are available through the digital archives to train their large language models that form the core of the AI programs. And so the Times is now pushing back on that, raising claims that there's been no sort of attribution or compensation for using all of their years of hard-earned, expensively investigated, terrific journalism to train these models. So that's one part of the lawsuit, is like using our stuff without permission to train these machines. But then maybe the more compelling part of the case is that these AI programs are now actually regurgitating verbatim large passages of New York Times articles if you put in the right prompt, and that is a violation of copyright. And so AI is pushing back on this, saying, no, we can use these available materials under the fair use doctrine, which requires that the user somehow transform the original copyrighted work. And so that's going to be sort of one of the main issues in the case. But this is sort of a trailblazing litigation. We don't have a lot of law on this yet. And so I'm just curious to hear from the panelists what you think of this lawsuit, if you think the claims have merits, where you think the claims might have some weaknesses. Sort of, where do you come down
on
this?
You've heard me reference it a couple of times already, so you probably have a sense that I think it's a really compelling lawsuit. I mean, the claims of willful infringement using all of that content, again, a lot of sweat, tears, maybe even some blood, seriously, as we talk about the types of reporting and investigations that happen in dangerous areas. For all of that content to be copied and fed in to train these models, unauthorized, uncompensated, I think there's a very, very solid argument for willful infringement, and certainly as it relates to the output of the stories that are almost regurgitated paragraph by paragraph in response to the prompts after the training and the grounding of those tools. And so as a huge content creator that we are, it's really important for these companies to understand that we're not just gonna sit back and not expect to be compensated for all of our decades and decades of hard work in journalism.
Yeah, so I think every generation which has experienced technological change has tried to manage the dislocations and problems of that change with the tools that it has available to it. And copyright is one of the tools available to us to manage disputes among change agents and workers in an economy which is in flux because of technology. In my own property class, I teach this case, Hedman against Pacific Air Transport, involving landowners suing airlines for flying over their lands, right? Which the old doctrine, as you probably remember, is ad civilem, ad infernus, which I always call the heaven and hell doctrine. So if you own the land, you own everything above and everything below. And so it looks like trespass would be a pretty good tool for allocating. So yeah, because these airplanes were annoying and flying over, they said they're scaring the cattle. So how do we deal with this problem of, when we invented this doctrine of heaven and hell, we didn't, you couldn't use someone else's airspace unless you built a building which was over it, or you threw something over it, or you had maybe smoke which was going over. So we have a new problem, and we're using a doctrine that problem wasn't designed for to try to adjudicate these rights. And the court, in that case, ended up deciding it wasn't a trespass. Maybe it could be if it was annoying enough, nuisance is available. Eventually, of course, we've got the FAA, we've got regulations. Over time, we start to develop tools that deal with this problem. In the news industry, of course, INS against AP is a famous old case dealing with the invention of the telegraph, essentially, right? That news can travel faster than the rotation of the earth, and therefore you can get morning papers out on the West Coast using news that people read about on the East Coast. So how do you deal with maybe unfair competition could be the rule to deal with that. And we developed a hot news doctrine. And so now maybe copyright is our kind of most famous, well-known tool for dealing with the use of each other's expression of ideas, but then we fight over whether or not it's really expression of its ideas. I think copyright is a really bad tool. And it could be a better tool. One of the reasons it's really bad is because it's so damn long. It's life of the author plus 70 years or 95 years for works of hire, which is, in economic terms, it's forever. It warps the entire conversation. I was on a panel about the Andy Warhol case last time, and it was like, it almost wouldn't matter who won that case if copyright weren't outrageously long. It serves no useful purpose. The best models in terms of incentive to produce that I read about suggest that copyright should be more like 15 years once renewable. I mean, can you imagine a world where everything that's more than 30 years old is freely usable? Why not? That's a better world, I think. But we can argue about that. But one thing I think we can't argue about is that it really is too long as it is. So that's one of the issues with using copyright here is you deprive these models of a whole bunch of training data precisely because it sweeps in so much, for 95 years. Maybe it would be a better tool if it swept in kind of less expression. Now that said, so I think the conventional wisdom has been among academics at least, that this is kind of a misuse of copyright when it concerns the training data. So this is just the expression that I take, all the web pages and articles and books that I feed into the model. I don't show them to anybody else. I just feed them into the model to learn, and then I throw it away. So the copy is only used in the same way that you would use a copy. You read it and you put it down. There's a separate issue about, if the model somehow produces an exact duplicate of what it's learned. Well, the model has violated a copyright, possibly. We'd have to figure out whether that's a fair use. It's probably not, right? A verbatim copy. But the issue of the training data, I think, is the big one. And so the conventional wisdom is that, that seems like a classic fair use under a whole bunch of cases, Google Books case and others. But there's recently an article by James Grohman and I forget someone else who kind of tried to put more air into this. It's like saying there really may be something here that maybe copyright is about or can be used for or should be used for situations where people make copies to enable a service that scales very broadly in a way which disrupts industries on account of some kind of free riding. And that is what's going on here, right? So these industries are, you know, taking for free all of this effort and using it to create something of value. Now, the thing they're creating of value is transformative. They hope it is. In fact, when it doesn't transform and it produces verbatim output, that's a bug. They don't want that to happen. Nobody wants that to happen. But that transformation is on account of and is free riding on all these efforts. So, you know, ultimately, I don't know how this should come out. I hate copyright as a tool because I think it is a misshapen, you know, Disney lobbied, you know, transmogrified, you know, monster of a statue. The principles, though, that like we need legal tools to manage this very disruptive transition, like we do. Unfortunately, this statute is one of the major tool that we have. So those are my initial thoughts. I don't know how to come out on it, other than I wish that Congress were functional. If Congress were functional, then we could say, oh, here's a problem. Let's have some hearings and think about how to deal with this problem, and maybe we can pass a statute. But, you know, Congress does a bunch of dumb things these days. It doesn't really focus on real problems.
I was just going to say, completely agree with you about the fact that the first part of it, the training data, is probably not a very good copyright case. However, think about what's really going to happen when, on the second part of this, and I'm not sure I agree with you that the fact that just quoting out of the CNN or the New York Times is a bug and not what they really want to do. Because if essentially what they're trying to do is use this as your front page, so you go there every day, you just go to your AI assistant, and you say, well, can you show me all the interesting news things that are out there today from my favorite sources? Okay, now you don't need to go to the New York Times, which you would otherwise have to pay for, but you're getting the value of everything that they're doing. So I also agree with Christian that, you know, we don't have the best tools right now, but this may be the only thing that we can use because I don't see Congress doing it.
And I was just going to say, you mentioned Congress and regulation, and the question is regulation the answer by government or self-regulation the answer? I know that a few days ago, 20 of these tech companies entered into a tech accord to combat deceptive use of AI in the 2024 elections, because there are going to be 40 elections around the world where 4 billion people are going to be voting, more than 40 countries around the world. And so they reached this accord at the Munich Securities Conference, outlining a variety of principles relating to detection of deceptive AI. Noble thought and cause, right? But at the end of the day, it's not necessarily enforceable. So figuring out what degree of regulation, whether it's self-regulation and or legislative regulation, is going to be really important.
And you think Elon Musk is going to follow that?
He signed it, okay. But they were the only one, I noted this, they were the only one that said, yes, we're signing on to this to combat AI threats while protecting free speech and maximizing transparency. And so obviously, as First Amendment attorneys, we all want to protect free speech, but, you know, disinformation in a democracy is really dangerous.
So just picking up on this thread about AI disrupting the market by creating the content that you would otherwise have to pay for. In addition to these litigations about copyright infringement, we're also seeing some news media organizations or other companies that generate content licensing their content to the AI companies so that at least they're compensated economically for the work product that's being used. And I guess my question is, like, is that a good idea? Because you're getting money in the short term, but aren't you just helping train the computer program that's going to put you out of business in the long run.
Do you think the New York Times is going to settle this?
Well, my suspicion is that this litigation will lead to more just and favorable terms for news organizations, and that perhaps is probably the impetus for the lawsuit. Apparently, the companies were in negotiation before they filed the lawsuit, and the New York Times just felt that whatever was offered in terms of licensing fees wasn't sufficient. So I really do think that ultimately the litigation is going to be helpful to generate more favorable terms for these companies.
Yeah, markets allocate scarce resources, and they encourage people to provide things that are scarce, right? So markets are tools for doing this. And back when IMS against AP was decided, I mean, the problem there was, right, so news would happen on the East Coast, and it would be wired to the West, and then people would read the news on the East Coast and wire the news to the West Coast, and then kind of copycat papers would be able to report on things that other people spent money reporting on, and it would come out at the same time in the morning papers on the West Coast. And this was seen as kind of unfair in a way, the worry was, like, you know, copycats, how could you fund the news? And there, at least, the court used this kind of unfair competition law to kind of keep them out for 24 hours. It really did a kind of admin law type thing, right? It wasn't a standard kind of remedy. It wasn't 24 hours. Maybe it was just long enough to get the benefit and send it down to the court below to figure out how long kind of copycats had to hold out and let the wire service, which originally
with the NBA case that. That is like 5 minutes, maybe, I think is
right.
You know, so the time is going down.
But even if OpenAI and some other companies settle with New York Times, like, this technology is here. You know, it's going to be used in China and in Indonesia and throughout Europe and India, and like, it's not complicated. It's actually, you know, you can go watch a YouTube video and learn pretty quickly how to build your own little GPT, right? And so the underlying technology is not hard. Unlike building nuclear weapons, it doesn't take the resources of a nation state to gather the materials together to train one of these large models. So I'm kind of less sanguine that we can kind of settle with a few companies and be okay with it, because other people are going to train these really great models, right? Not do it. So maybe we need to rethink, like. So there's value created by reporters. There's human value. Like, it's valuable to us that human beings go out and talk to other human beings about what's happened, and they tell us about this, right? This has been important to human beings since before we were human beings, I think. And so that's a valuable thing. We want to keep having that happen. I think it's important to remember that kind of markets where people pay for this in a kind of transactional way, that's a technique, it's a strategy for getting this value out of all of us. But it may not be the only way. And it wouldn't be the kind of the first industry, I don't think, which kind of that standard market description of how it should work is threatened by some new technology. So
the models in that industry have changed so many times over the past 100 years.
Right.
I mean, you go, well, it's almost like music too. You go from, you've got to do it live, and that's where you make all your money. So then you make more money recording.
Or you have a patron, right?
Right, or you have a patron, exactly. Patron is you have to find one person to finance it. You know, and now with streaming, we're back to the fact that music acts make more money going live than they really make off what they record anymore. And it's the same thing with news. You know, you've had advertising models, you've had subscription models, you've had all sorts of different things. But, you know, that's going to continue to change as the environment changes.
And I'm going to even pivot from news for a second, because I wanted to mention something that just happened 2 days ago in the entertainment industry. And OpenAI released or previewed its model of text to video, which was such a big sort of earthquake in the industry, so much so that Tyler Perry announced he was going to put a pause on his like $800 billion commitment to studio expansion, because the technology was so amazing, being able to recreate scenes in such a way. It's like, well, do you need all these video editors and sound editors and all these other crew people? It's just, you know, I mean, potentially 250,000 of people can lose jobs over the next several years as this technology rolls out. And even he's saying, even though he obviously benefits by saving costs and the efficiency, even he's saying, well, wait, where's the regulation here? Because I'm also a content creator and I'm an artist and I'm worried about our industry. So it's just really, I mean, it's just it's so complicated.
Right, I mean, just because AI can do it doesn't mean that we should make the choice that it should or will do it to the detriment of large swaths of our population. So, I do, how am I doing on time, Richard?
You have 7 more minutes.
Oh, okay. Are there audience questions? We have another really interesting topic to discuss, the First Amendment and AI, but I don't know if we can do it in 7 minutes, so maybe we'll just take some questions if anybody, if not, we'll go into that. Yes, over there.
Hi, so my question is about deepfakes in elections. So there's been a lot of different statutes that have come forth across the country about not posting or creating deepfake content within a certain time frame of elections. That time frame could range from 30 days, 90 days, 60 days. What are you all's thoughts on the fact that things live on the internet forever and the attempts to try and control or have time parameters on when deepfake content can be posted?
I do think, to quote Twitter, or X, sorry, that there's a balance, right, between freedom of speech and making sure that we are combating deceptive AI. I mean, as Ted was saying, or actually maybe it was Christian as well, if these states are legislating because they feel they need to protect their electorate, that is one solution in terms of the time limits, the term limits. Obviously, you know, there's a discomfort as a First Amendment attorney to do anything that seems to be just unnecessarily impeding freedom of speech, but it's, you know, it is somewhat necessary if these kinds of tools and the altered images and video and audio can impact an election. So I'm not a legislator, but I do think that there needs to be some sort of regulation around.
Well, and this is time sensitive, clearly. I mean, if something comes out, well, I mean, what we know is an October surprise, something comes out right before an election, and, you know, it's not as big a problem 3 weeks later after the election when people can look at it and think about it and they don't have to act on it right away. So, you know, the timing issues make sense if you're talking about protecting elections.
I think it's a massive problem, and I don't know what the answer is. One of the reasons, I think, more than just like throwing an election or changing an election, my biggest worry is the kind of universalizing of cynicism and mistrust, because, you know, I think that is that's the way toward fascism. Right, when no one believes anything they hear from any source, and then they trust their person, they put all their trust in their person. That to me is a real problem. So I also think that that kind of trying to deceive people is one of the basic human wrongs that we commit to one another, and it's one of the ways that we are indecent to each other. And so to me, it is a prime target for regulation and a reminder to each other about how we're expected to behave to one another. So. So, regulation, but, you know, obviously there are going to be kind of state actors who have a significant interest in clouding the kind of epistemological picture of any election, so.
But it's a little like copyright, right? I mean, we have laws, we have fraud laws.
Yeah.
But they may not be adequate for this particular moment, because there may not be monetary aspects to this particular fraud, so it may not fall within some of those laws. You know, it's, you know, we have a lot of laws against lying and deception, but it hadn't stopped a lot of people in a lot of circumstances. So, although one of the things we're finding is that, you know, if somebody I don't know, just think of somebody in the back of your head was a constant liar. Once those things get into court, it may be a slow process, but you know, we've seen, for example, with the January 6th trials, I mean, they lost all of them. There were like 60 of them. And so we have the rules around. The question is, are the rules that we have and the policies that we have and the ways of enforcing them adequate?
But I also want you to imagine, though, that these laws, like all laws, like they rely on trust. We think, oh, we could just make the right laws and then the system takes care of itself. But it doesn't matter what laws you have if substantively people are bent toward evil. Because you can imagine someone reporting perfectly accurate things and then being prosecuted for deep fakes. These are fakes. This is fake news. Right. And a prosecution happens.
It's the liar's benefit.
And then some people believe that it really is, and there's no way to prove it necessarily. And then people have stories about how they were come up with and articles about it. And you can see it the other way, too. There's a real deep fake. It's prosecuted. And then there are a bunch of people who think this is a politically motivated prosecution of people who are just trying to tell the truth. So it takes us down a very dark road if we can't, like, there's an underlying kind of breaking of political ties, that if that underlying kind of cooperative thread is not nurtured, no laws are going to fix the problem either way, I think.
I see Richard approaching. That means our time is up. So I want to thank our panel. Sorry for ending on a bit of a dark note, but these are important issues to be thinking about. So thank you so much for sharing all of your insights.
All is doing have a great weekend.
Those movies are really cool, though. They're really fun. So,
there is a movie in this.
Yeah.
A fabulous, fabulous day. A few things before we close and head to the reception, which will be right out there. Don't forget to download your conference materials. There's some fabulous stuff on AI, including some memoranda from judges about people being required to assert that there's no AI used in these pleadings, things like that. On some of the other sessions, some amazing background material, well worth you pulling it down. So please get that before you head out. Take a picture, the Bit.ly Bar Media 2024. It'll stay up through the end of March, and then I'm going to pull it down. So you have a little while longer to get it. Many thanks, of course, to the panelists and moderators for giving their time and insights. I want to thank again our sponsors. In particular, well, you see them on the screen. I want to give particular shout outs to our lead sponsors, CNN, the State Bar of Georgia, which provides this fabulous space and your parking, and the Department of Journalism at the University of Georgia, which came in at the last second to help us out financially. These are all wonderful sponsors. Please thank them when you see them, because it makes the difference in keeping this conference going. There's a questionnaire that will likely come your way. Please fill it out. I want to thank the planning committee members that have worked so hard to pull us together. They're all there in very small type, but they work their tails off to make this thing go. And in particular, Frank Lamonte, who took on this assignment even before he had finished unpacking his moving boxes after he came here from Florida. So I really want to thank him as he made the switch from the Breckner Center, where he had been a panelist here so many times. Now he's at CNN and helping lead the very conference with which he participated. And of course, the amazing
Claire Norens, without whom we could do nothing without deep thinking. So thank you so much for all of that. And somewhere in the back is Professor John Peters, who may have slipped out to head back home. He had family coming in. He understands more than many the importance of getting journalists, judges, and lawyers in a room to get a discussion going. So important to have that discussion on an ongoing basis. There is one sobering thing that I want to point out, that yet again today, another big announcement of a major news organization shutting down. Vice News laid off 200, 300 people even while we were speaking today. Just 2 days after winning a George Polk Award for reporting on Russian mercenaries, serious news journalism is under great threat. And so conferences like this help us understand that threat, understand perhaps some solutions. So thank you for coming, for participating. Let's go outside and have a glass and celebrate what we've achieved and what we hope we'll achieve moving forward. Thank you.
Anytime you're doing this, you are in.
Thank you for that, because in the past I've always been.
Well, but it saves us and it makes a permanent record.
Yeah, awesome. Okay. So just jump on your settings.